There are so many heroes here today. There are so many great examples of standing up against tyranny, telling the truth in the face of adversity. And I talked a little bit about this yesterday. William Rodriguez, imagine, he's the master janitor in one of the towers. He has the master key. The building's on fire. He stays in there with the firefighters. He takes them up to the top. He personally escorts hundreds of people out, physically pushing 50 people out of the door, goes back in, and the building collapses on him, and he's the last non-emergency worker to be pulled from the rubble. But that's not where the courage ends. That's where it begins. William Rodriguez was then whisked to the White House, all over national TV, hundreds of shows. He was everywhere. He's this big hero. The Republicans wanted him to run for Congress, wanted him to be their minion. He was offered millions and millions of dollars. But then he kept talking about, well, there were explosions going off. People with their skin burned off. And before the buildings collapsed on the bottom floors, this was happening. And they said, shut up about that and just take the millions. How many of you could say, I'm not taking the millions? He did it. So he not only saved those people, he also refused all those millions of dollars. And they paid off so many of the victims. But he said no. And now he's traveled the world from Venezuela to Malaysia to Japan, dozens and dozens and dozens of countries, on national television, speaking to the people. There's not a news blackout globally. They've been in Germany. They've been in England. They've been in Italy. They've been in Russia. They've been all over the world. And now he's here for you today in Los Angeles. And William Rodriguez has told me this is one of the last times he'll be in the U.S. giving speeches and talking, because he believes he can have more of an effect globally. So one of the real heroes of 9/11, wasn't a firefighter, wasn't a police officer, didn't even sign on for it. He went in there. That building was on fire. He went in there. He stayed in there until it collapsed. And so we're honored to have with us today William Rodriguez. William, come on up here. I tell you, I just love being around all these heroes. Here you go, my friend.
I just came back from Malaysia, where we had Dr. Tun Mahathir Mohamad, the most powerful man in Malaysia, listening to our story and opening the doors all over the nation. And it was a historical moment. Historical moment because it was the first time that a survivor of 9/11 goes directly to a Muslim country to talk about 9/11 and the effect that it really had on them. You know, we have criminalized, demonized the Islamic world because of 9/11. So to have the actual last survivor going over there and telling them what really happened was an eye-opener.
Here they you have Dr. Mohamad. The lady is the chancellor to the United Nations. This is the meeting, the second meeting we had with him. And the press coverage was national. We went on every television show. We were presented for 10 days, prime time, on the news, opening news every single night. And when I left, thank you. When I left on Friday, the actual comment on national news was that the Malay mindset about 9/11 has been changed forever after our visit. Prior to that, I went to Venezuela. Venezuela, I had a meeting directly with the second man in power after Hugo Chavez, Nicolas Maduro, the president of the National Assembly, who actually was very concerned about my safety. He gave me formal protection in Venezuela. He said, well, you know, you're in a very difficult situation here. Mind you that you probably didn't get the news over here, but an FBI agent, when asking around the hotel for the list of the guests of the hotel that we were staying at. And when they find out about it, they gave us 5 bodyguards round the clock because they said, it's a possibility they could do something to you in our country and blame us for it. So we're gonna protect you. And they ordered that a documentary about my life was to be filmed on the grounds of the palace. For 5 days I was filming at the palace. So they will have a historical evidence if something happened to me. So it's not in this country alone that they have done that. Here's the march that I did against the war in New York. I was highly criticized. I'm on the news in New York. I'm the only expert about 9/11 for Telemundo, Univision, and CNN en Español. And I was highly criticized on that march that I did. So I said, okay, no problem. I won't do it. I do something different next week. I didn't have soldiers. So, the 9/11 report. Okay. Let's pass the report better. That's the truck. I was pulled right from under the truck. You see that black hole right under the truck? That's what I was pulled from. All right. Don't hold it against me. Remember, I did not know. I did not know. And when they name you national hero, whatever, you know, you just go. One media expert for all the different channels, the newspapers. I was writing legislations. I was just a janitor at the World Trade Center. And I was passing laws. I did the Tax Relief Act for victims of terrorism. I worked very hard on it. I work on legislation for scholarship programs for the victims and the survivors, and they all passed. So, you know, at least we did something positive. This is the investigation request. Now I'm going to start about 9/11. Let's see. Can you hear me? Okay. Let me go on the front. That way you can. Well, for those who don't know me, William Rodriguez is my name. I worked in the building for 20 years. 20 years of my life, I was a janitor. I was a person in charge of cleaning all the stairwells of the North Tower. From the 20 years that I have in the building, 10 of those years, I worked at the governor's office. Governor Cuomo was a prior governor to Pataki. And I used to be the one that cleaned his office, did the whole organization of the press conferences, and I guess by osmosis of being 10 years in there, I learned the whole process of how to set up a press conference after 9/11, how to set up the bills that you saw in legislation, because it was 10 years of learning and listening without knowing that I was doing that, of how to deal with politicians. And that's how I guess God really prepares you and gives you a mission. He really gives you a mission. Now, it's been 5 years, 5 years of my life dedicated to this, 5 years that I have been, since the moment that I was pulled from the rubble to this moment, fighting for victims' rights, immigrants' rights, the truth about 9/11, disaster management. I mean, one issue after the other against the war in Iraq. That's what an activist does. They jump from one issue to the other until they make a change. We have saw that after 9/11, that beautiful thing that we had in the 60s, that activism was totally erased because of the Patriot Act. The Patriot Act totally eliminated 50 years of civil rights. Now, when they use 9/11, our tragedy, our despair, to create this policy, this agenda against the people here and abroad, of course, I had a responsibility to open my mouth and complain. Now 20 years of my life in that building, I'm just going to jump into the story of what happened to me that day. I went to work late, and again, I really believe that there was a mission for me that day, because if I was there at the regular time, at 8 o'clock, I would have been at the top of the building, at Windows of the World, and I would have died. So I came in late, 8:30 in the morning. I'm on the basement. The building has 6 sub-levels of basement, B1, B2, B3, all the way down to B6. 6 up levels.
On the B1 level, you have all the support companies for the company that dealt with the World Trade Center. Mine was ABM, American Building Maintenance. Now, that company actually have the structural contracts, has the painter contracts, they have the mechanical contracts. So our office was on the B1 level. As I was talking to a supervisor at 8:46, we're like chit-chatting, and all of a sudden we hear, "Pah!" Very strong. Boom! An explosion so hard that pushed us upwards. Upwards. Now, 20 years in the building. Remember that. And it came from the basement between the B2 level and the B3 level. And at that moment, I thought it was the mechanical room where they have all the pumps and the generators for the building, that maybe a generator just blew up on the basement. Now, 20 years in the building, you know something that comes from the bottom and something that comes from the top. At that moment, everybody started screaming. And it was, I mean, the explosion was so hard that all the walls cracked. The false ceiling fell on top of us. The sprinkler system got activated. And when I went to verbalize that it was a generator, we hear, boom, all the way on the top. The impact of the plane on the top. Two different events, two different times. Later on, I thought that they probably didn't synchronize it well. Because that came out on the investigation that probably this explosion was to weaken the base and the foundation of the building to be synchronized with the heat on the top so it will fall automatically, which it didn't. Now, when that happened, screams everywhere. A person comes running into the office saying, "Explosion, explosion, explosion." His hands were extended and his skin was pulled from under his armpits all the way to the top of the fingertips, and it was hanging on both hands. And I didn't know what it was. I thought it was a piece of clothing. And then I realized it was his skin, and I said, "What happened? What happened?" And when I look at his face finally, he got missing pieces of his face. A black guy named Felipe David from Honduras, who I didn't know. He worked for Aramark, the company that put all the soda machines into the machines, the candies into the candy machines. And he was located on the B2 level when this explosion happened, and he put his hands to cover his face because there was fire. And that's how he got burned. That's Felipe David here. See, this whole thing was hanging. On the other side, you don't see it there. He was burnt as well. So at that moment, I said, "Don't move." I was going to pick up the phone to call the emergency medical unit that was located on the building 2, the south tower. Building 1 and building 2 connected through the basement. And I wanted to pick up the phone when I hear another explosion. And that was so hard that the building oscillated so much that the walls cracked again. And people thought that it was an earthquake because they're going under the door frames thinking that it was an earthquake. They say, "No, I think it's a bomb." And the reason I said that, again, osmosis, because I survived the 1993 bombing. I was stuck in an elevator in 1993 for 4 hours. They have to break through a wall to get us out. So automatically, I thought it was a bomb. And I said, "We got to get out." So I took those 15 people. I led them out of the office, through the loading dock, through a hill outside the building with Mr. Felipe David on my back until I saw an ambulance. Get out of the building. I stopped the ambulance, put Mr. Felipe David inside. He goes into a coma. And that's when I hear automatically, "A plane hit the building, a plane hit the building." There was a security guard standing right next to me, and his radio was going, "There's a plane hit the building, a plane hit the building." So now I'm at the base of the building. When I turn around, you know when you're on the base of the building and you look up, you don't see the top? That's exactly what happened. But I saw the hole, I saw the fire, I saw the smoke, and all of a sudden I realized that I couldn't see the antenna off the top of the building. And what came to my mind right away was, oh my God, the people from Windows of the World, the restaurant that was on the top of the floors on that building, 106th floor. I had breakfast with those people every morning. I started cleaning the stairwells from the top down. So they have an employee's kitchen, and I will go there and talk with these people all the time. Mind you that the 76 people that died there, I knew them all. So all of a sudden, when I see that, I start screaming, we got to go back, we got to go back. Nobody wanted to go back. The supervisor, Anthony Saltalamacchia, said, no, Rodriguez, you stay here. A guy three times my size, weightlifter, and he's telling me, hey, just stay here. Say, no, we got to go back in. We got to help those people. He said, no, 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 you stay here now. I took the radio from the security guard, and I ran inside the building through the basement all the way again to the North Tower. There was water all over because the sprinkler system, again, why would the sprinkler system get activated on the basement when the plane hit on the top? Think about it. Does that make sense? No. I find water all over. I run straight to the South Tower where they had the OCC, the Operation Control Center, that was created after 1993. They spent $155 million to retrofit the building and to supposedly straighten it out after the bombing and to set up a whole security system. And that was actually the control center. You know what? When I got there, I started hitting the window. There was nobody there. There was nobody there. The control center, where they have all the cameras, all the recordings. I found one guy called Jimmy Barrett. He was on the other building. He didn't know what was happening. I'm screaming, you got to get out. You got to get out. That gives you an idea. He was on the basement on the South Tower. That gives you an idea how many people died on the other tower without ever knowing what happened, on the basement. He just happened to come up from the basement. And then I found a lady that worked for the Marriott Hotel, staying in a podium like this, on an entrance for the employees for the Marriott. She heard the whole thing. But she said, what are you doing here? Get out now. And you know what she said? I can't. I'm a new employee. I don't want to get fired. Just the ignorance. Because she didn't know. So I push her out. Ran to the other tower. On the North Tower, again, there's water all over. I found one guy that worked for the recycling company. And he said, I hear screams. The World Trade Center had 150 elevators in the complex. I put my ear on one of the elevators, and I heard two people stuck in the elevator screaming for help, saying, we're drowning. We're going to drown. That didn't make sense either. I'm like, you know, I'm trying to understand what's going on. He said, what? And it was all the water from the sprinkler system was going down the elevator shaft, and they got encapsulated because the elevator went down between the B2 and the B3 level, and they have all the water up to here. So at that moment, and let me tell you, I was never a believer. I was agnostic. I didn't believe in anything. And at that moment, I said, God, please help me. And I looked around and I found a metal pipe in an area that was supposed to be clean of construction debris. And I took that pipe, put it on the wall, on the doors of the elevator. And with the help of Barrett, we opened the doors. The doors opened this way because it was a freight elevator. When the bottom door hit the floor, all the water that was on my side went rushing in with more power. And the screaming was worst. And when I looked down, it was too deep. And I said again, God, please help me. And all of a sudden, I remember that in the area where they have the trash compactors for the building, the electricians, they always have the ladders that they use to change light bulbs and do the wiring. They always had them tied up with chains on the loading dock area. And they tied them up because you could go there with the truck and steal them. And I said, let me find one. Let me find just one. And as I got there, ladies and gentlemen, the only one that was not tied up was the longest one of all of them. So that was a miracle by itself. That was there to be used. I took that ladder, put it on my back, went inside, went on the elevator shaft, dropped that, went in, opened the grid, got these two people out, one of them, Salvatore Giambanco, a painter for the Port Authority, which I did not know either, and a delivery guy. And he's telling me that there was a huge explosion in the basement. There was fire, and they tried to cover themselves from the fire. They went into the elevator, and the door closed, and they started going down the elevator, and they lost power. That's his actual words. Got them outside the building, put them in an ambulance, and went back into the building. And everybody, oh, don't go back in. What, are you crazy? I say, no entiendo. no entiendo. But I prayed in English. And he say, ay, Dios mío. So I get back into the basement, and I found one person, police officer David Lim. Now, he was the person in charge of the K-9 unit and in charge of all the rescue efforts for the Port Authority. And he said, Willie, do you have the key? I said, yes. He meant, did I have the master key? There were only 5 master keys in the whole complex. The Port Authority had the other 4. They were trained on egress, escape, first aid, rescue. They were the first one to run out. This is the master key, ladies and gentlemen. We call this the key of hope because it gave hope to a lot of people. I said, let's go. We get to the base, from the basement to the lobby. And when we get to the lobby, the firemen are there waiting with something called the fire access key. It's a key that they put on any elevator. And if the elevator is on the basement, they will go up. If it's on the top, it will go down to pick them up. I said, what are you waiting? There's no elevator. Follow me. I know the best way to go up. We started going through the staircases. Now, it was so hard for those poor people because they have so much equipment in their bags. We're talking about 70 to 125 pounds of equipment in their bags. And as we go up, they started bumping against us, the people coming down, because the stairwells were not wide enough. Look. Well, it's not, I thought I had the staircases there. But anyway, I'll find the picture later. It was not wide enough. So we start making it up the staircase. And as we go up, we hear small explosions going off. Pa, pa, different areas. And I said to the fireman, what's that? And they said, one of them told me, I think it's the gas tanks from the kitchens. Now, that did not make sense because it was a Class A building. All the kitchens were electrical. All the kitchens were electrical. So that did not make sense. What are those explosions coming from? Now, again, why is this key so important? Because Class A building, the codification in New York, is that any skyscraper, 3 doors will not open on the staircases, 1 will open. 3 won't open, 1 will open. So we have to go and open all those doors that did not open. In 1993, the fire department lost so much time breaking doors, trying to get to the floors. So that's why this key was so important. And it opened the whole thing, the whole complex. And the reason I got this key was because in 1996, I fell down the stairwell, and I didn't get help for several hours. For 3 or 4 hours, they couldn't find me. So I did an arbitration case against the Port Authority, and I sued for the key, and I got the key. And I won. And I guess that's when I got the experience of suing and doing all this. All the losses after just was an upgrade. So as we go up, you know, one thing that people don't talk about is that, and it breaks my heart, is the amount of screams that I heard of people stuck inside the elevators that were not being able to be helped. People screaming for help. You ask me what is the biggest nightmare I have. I have two, and that's probably the one that I recall almost every day. Every time I go into an elevator, if I go up to my room over here, it's just in my mind, listening to those people screaming for help. And it breaks your heart. It really does. So those people never had a chance. So I continue going up. One person tells me, there's a man in a wheelchair on the 27th floor that needs help. I told the fire department, I went down 2 floors to let them know that, you know, there was somebody in a wheelchair. And the reason I went down, remember, I have no equipment in my back. I have no fireproof jackets. I have nothing. And I did the staircases every day. So I was in that time in a better physical condition than even the firemen. Because that was my routine. That was my job. So when I go down and I tell them, the fireman tells me, we leave the handicapped people always for the last, so they will not impede the rescue effort of the majority of the masses. We get there. When we got to the 27th floor, the whole unit of firemen collapsed on the corridor, one after the other, because they couldn't continue going up. It was physically impossible for them to continue. They took their equipment, they took their jackets, they took their boots, they dropped themselves on the floor. A very shocking moment for me, because I said, oh my God, I feel like I have to go alone now. Remember, David Lim said, Willie, do you know this floor? I said, yeah, I know this floor. He said, where can I get water? He said, on the other side. There's a machine. So let's go. He breaks the machine. We start taking bottled water, putting it on trash cans, and bringing it to the firemen and giving them the bottled water. I remember I called my mother from a phone that was working in that office. Call her. My mother is in Puerto Rico. But I wanted to let her know that there was an accident in case she heard something on the news, that I was okay. When she picked up the phone, she was like, what are you doing there? Everybody in the world knew but us what was happening. She said, get out now. And I said, I can't. I'm helping these people. They don't know the building. But don't worry. And I lied to her. I said, I'm going to get up to a certain part, but I'm not going to get to the area where they have the fire. When my actual intention was to go to windows of the world and help my friends. That was my motivating and the power that was actually pushing me to go to the top. Because I knew these people were stuck in there. I hung up on the phone and I had calls from my supervisor say, Rodriguez, abandon the building right now. Abandon the building right now. I say, I can't. I'm helping the fire department. He said, that's not your job. Get out now. I turn off the radio, and I continue going up by myself.
opening door, letting people out until I got to the 33rd floor. When I get to the 33rd floor, and the reason that I went to the 33rd floor, it was because I had a closet inside there where I have all supplies. Every 16 floors, I had a little closet with supplies. And I wanted to get the dust masks to give it to the people that were coming out because of the smoke that it was coming in the staircase. It was an acrid smoke. It was like ammonium stuck in your throat. I spoke to Professor Jones about it. I spoke to experts who said, it sounds like ammonium nitrate. I mean, I'm not an expert on those things. And as I went in to get those masks, I found a lady sitting on the floor, trembling. Blonde lady, no shoes, in a fetal position. And I said, what are you doing here? Get out! And she said, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. She was a new employee. She didn't know where to go. Now, that gives you an idea. Also, the World Trade Center did drills twice a year. Twice a year. With a population of 50,000 employees. Come on. It should have been a mandatory training that anybody that works in the building should have learned where the exits were. And that's one of the lawsuits that we are actually trying to establish, that every building now that is over a certain amount of floors should have mandatory training, because the turnaround of people getting fired, retiring, getting hired is a constant. And at the World Trade Center, imagine, it was a city within a city. It was a constant. This lady didn't know what to do. So I stood her up, put her on the stairwell. There were people coming down. And I say, take her out, please. As I went back inside the office, the corridor, I heard the strangest thing. Now, on the floor above me, the 34th floor, I heard heavy equipment being moved around. You know the dumpsters? When they scratch the floor, those steel dumpsters, it sounded just like it. It was the first time that I felt fear through the whole ordeal, because it was an empty floor. I knew for a fact that was a hollowed out floor by construction. There was no walls, there was no ceiling, there was no wires, there was nothing there. It was a floor that was emptied out over 8 months before. So there was nobody supposedly to be there. And for me to hear that kind of sound really scared me. So much that I bypassed that floor. That was the only floor I did not open the door. And I continued going up until I got to the 39th floor. When I got to the 39th floor, from the opposite staircase, there were three staircases, A, B, and C. Police officer David Lim came up with two firemen. And as we were talking about what was going to be our next move, we hear, boom! The impact on the other tower. And it was so hard that our building oscillated so much that we lost practically our footing. And all of a sudden we hear, boom, 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 boom. And on the radio, we lost 65. We lost 65, meaning that the 65th floor collapsed floor by floor by floor by floor up to the 44th floor, the Sky Lobby, five flights away. And I started screaming, we got to go up. We got to go up. Officer Lim said, Rodriguez, you've done enough, but you don't get paid for this. And I said, what? I'm going up. And he said, no. You stay here, you're still a civilian, and you are my responsibility. And I said, sorry, I'm not giving the key to anybody, I'm going up. And he said, better if you give me a hand with the person on the wheelchair on the 27th floor. And he said, you know, David, I'm going to go down, but I'm coming right up. I'm going to help you with that, but I'm coming right up. So I ran down to the 27th floor. When I ran to the 27th floor, I screamed to the firemen, I have orders to get this guy out right now. The guy was taken out of the wheelchair. He was put on a rescue basket, all tied up. Three guys stood up and said, let's go. We grabbed him. We started going down the stairwell.
As we go down, it was like the movie The Tower in Inferno, because chunks were coming all over us, from the ceiling, from the walls. And then the light, the fluorescent lights, the long ones, that's what we had on the stairwells, because the building was oscillating so much, you could hear them breaking in unison, going floor by floor, clash, 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 clash. And we lost visibility as we go down. Emergency lights, some floors they worked, other floors they didn't. Calls for us to get out of the building, we never got them, even though they said that they did. That was a famous lawsuit against Motorola because the radios didn't work out. As we go down, we make it to the lobby. We make it to the lobby. When I get to the lobby, what do I see? The elevators for the passengers are open from the bottom like this. The doors, the aluminum doors. Indication that something powerful came from the bottom. I mean, I don't have to be a genius to realize that something was wrong there. And all of a sudden, one of the firemen tells me, please, go get the ambulance ready. Now, the other tower already collapsed as we were going down. I remember telling the guy on the wheelchair, don't worry, after this, we're going to get a beer. And he was going, yes, 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 yes. I don't even drink. But I wanted to give him motivation, disposition, enthusiasm to continue. And I was looking for a way to digest what was happening. As I was told to get the ambulance ready, I realized that the whole area on my left was destroyed. There was dust everywhere. The security cameras were hanging by a wire. That beautiful marble, anybody that went into the World Trade Center, remember that marble at the entrance? That was all pulled out, broke into pieces on the floor, and the only thing you saw was the cement patches where the marble was before. I get to the front of the building, the West Side Highway entrance, the main entrance. As I get there, all the glass is broke into pieces. There's not an intact piece of glass anywhere. There's no revolving door either. I get to the front, and all of a sudden I hear, don't look back! Don't look back! The police had the area cordoned out on the World Financial Center, almost a block and a half away, and they're telling me not to look back. And what do you do when they tell you that? I turn around and I look back, and ladies and gentlemen, I saw the bodies of the people that jumped out of the building. I saw, like, they melted on the floor because of the impact. And that lady from the 33rd floor that I helped to escape, I found it cut in half because a glass came from the top of the building and cut it in half like a guillotine. And I said, God, what is this? What is this? And I hear, run, run, run. I look at the left side, and I see the Marriott Hotel almost gone. Bodies everywhere. And I said, God, please help me. And the only thing I see is a fire truck in front of the building. And I just slid right under the fire truck, and all of a sudden the building started to destroy itself on top. And you hear, boom, 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 and the truck going down. And all I said at that moment was, please don't let my mother see my body in pieces. Let her recognize my body. Please, please. I just didn't want my mother to see what I just saw. There was silence all of a sudden, and this cloud of dust came from all over. And then I said, I'm not dying of being squashed to death here, but now I'm going to die of asphyxia because you couldn't breathe. You feel your lungs expanding and contracting. And I said, this is going to be a slow death. And all I have in my mind was that poor lady cut in half. The most Dantesque thing I ever seen in my life. And at that very moment, I just said, I'm going to die. This is it. Many of you heard that I was a magician for 30 years. And one of the things that, you know, and I used to do the escape acts, you know, with the straight jackets and all those things. So one of the things they teach you is just, you know, make it last. So that's exactly what I did. I tried to control my breathing. I tried to control my concentration and see what happened. But I was expecting death. Luckily, CNN, Globovision from Brazil, they were across the street and they pinpointed the area. The last man came out from that area. And that's how they started doing the rescue effort. I was pulled from the rubble. They were confused because I have a jacket that says safety 11. It looks like a jacket for the fire department. So they thought I was a fireman. So I stayed within the perimeter, continuing looking for people. Remember, and I'm sorry to be graphical. Remember, I went back to the truck to see if there was anybody there. And I was pulled right at the nick of time because the tires of the truck just blew out when they pulled it out. So I was saved right on time. I went to the area where they had this bridge that connected the North Tower to the World Financial Center. That collapsed on top of fire trucks. I went under. I saw two boots. I pulled the boots. I stayed with the boots in my hand. And when I looked inside, I found the legs of a fireman. And I started screaming, and all the firemen came over. They started to rescue the body because there was nothing else there. And I stayed there for hours. I came out just to get water. And that's when I was grabbed by the news, and that's the news that you saw all over the world during those 3 days when they started interviewing me. And I say, I'm talking about the explosion that I heard, the person on the wheelchair, the whole thing. That day I did not sleep, neither I did the following day. I was being called from all over the world, round the clock. And the problem was that the lady from Globovision from Brazil sent a press release with my phone number on it. With my phone number on it. So I was getting called from Montevideo, from Argentina, from Kuwait. I was like, from all over. I'm like, how am I going to pay this bill? Anyway, after they recognized me, after during that time I organized the families, I did the Hispanic victims group because I saw that the Hispanic were not getting an equitative and balanced distribution of the funds that were given for the victims. So I went to Congress with a group of families to ask for a commission to be created to investigate 9/11. And as we went over there, you remember that the president said, we don't need an investigation. We know who did it. And that was the wrong thing to say to the families because then we pushed very hard and we got it. The problem is that we want to have a family member as part of the commission and they said, we don't want to allow that. And they never permitted it. We never had it. Now, we created the family steering committee. We put 167 questions out to the commission. From those, 27 were answered. What happened to the others? Then I was one of the last persons to testify, but they wanted my testimony behind closed doors. Everybody was testifying on national TV. You remember those hearings? I testified, and up to that moment, I thought they were going to do the right thing. Until the final report came in. When the final report came in, what a surprise. My testimony wasn't there, even though I was wine and dined by them. 22 people that I put them available, firemen, victims, survivors, that had similar experience, were never called. Ladies and gentlemen, David Lim, well, this is, can you put this on? We were cleaning the basement
of Tower 1 of the World Trade Center.
We heard something like a bomb.
Se oyó como una bomba y la luz como que se apagó.
And the light turned off.
Entonces, a la salida de la puerta, cuando
at the exit door, there was this fire, this ball of fire that came down and knocked us on the floor.
Y nos tumbó al piso porque nos dio el aire caliente de...
We were hit by hot air.
Nosotros nos caímos al piso y,
and the room was full of smoke.
Y el cuarto estaba lleno de humo. Y bueno, en ese momento
at that moment,
yo
I
creía que era una bomba
bomb
que había explotado en el edificio. Le dije a Chino, Chino, vamos a salir
I
de
said,
aquí.
Chino, let's get out of here.
Pues, él me dijo, no puedo salir porque
I
la pierna la tenía herida. Yo sabía que él no había metido una explosión de
I
aire caliente.
An
a mí los
there
pelos
was
se,
hot
me,
air.
Se me
my
quemaron.
Hair got burned. Now, this is Jose Sanchez. He was available to testify. He was in the basement. He was never called. The Chino guy, whatever who he was never called either. Now, Felipe David survived. He was in a coma for 13 weeks. They made an encounter for television, national television. And his story went all over, again, the world, but in Spanish. You see, our story in Spanish is perfect. I'll put it out there, we cover it. In English, it was totally edited, constantly. Salvatore Giambanco survived. His story was never told, even though the encounter was done for national TV. David Lim. Now, this is the reason that we do this. We owe the truth to the victims, survivors, and those affected by 9/11. The reason I do this is because I lost 200 friends of 9/11. 200 people that don't have the ability to call for the truth. They don't have a voice. And I'm alive because of a miracle. I was sent to the Governing Institute to train for political office. When I started asking questions, they all went the other way. You see, they wanted me to play ball. So, the motivation, the disposition, and the enthusiasm, I don't care about anything else. But I want the truth. You see, I've been offered everything, like they said. I had a television show on PBS in New York. They offered me what? Movies, books, everything. I always say, no, forget about it. It's not money. I was homeless. I raised $122 million. And don't take my word for it. Go on the internet. Do your own research. And you'll find it there. I did national PSA, public service announcement, for the community to raise funds. I never received one penny. I found myself living under a bridge. So don't get fooled by all of this old image. This is the same suit I had yesterday. The only thing that changed is the tie. So I do this by donations. I go all over the world, but we need to get the truth. So please stand up, take it upon yourself to ask real questions, and make a change. We need activism. We need disposition. We need you to actually ask those people in power to tell you what really happened. They have an agenda. They have used our tragedy to create this world war on terrorism. which is just a fallacy. Everybody else in the world is more prepared and with more information about 9/11 than we are. So please, get the facts. And God bless you.